Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Thank you for connecting and attending the DRISMI webinars. The DRISMI webinars are the webinars of the driving simulator of the Politecnico di Milano. The Politecnico di Milano has established a new laboratory, the driving simulator, that has been launched on last 3rd of February. The first four DRISMI webinars refer to Industry 4.0 and automotive design process, to intelligent transport systems and Industry 4.0 referring to traffic, to green vehicles and lightweight construction, to intelligent transport system and Industry 4.0 referring to human-machine interfaces. Today's agenda will focus on Industry 4.0 and automotive design process. Let us try to focus what does it mean, establishing a relationship between Industry 4.0 and automotive design process. Here you see in this slide the many components that a car is made from. In order to introduce an innovation in one of these components or in the whole car, usually designers have to check whether the final customer will perceive the innovation. Otherwise, the customer will not buy the car with the innovation that is going to introduce. In order to assess this perception, a driving simulator is very much important because by means of the driving simulator, we allow to check whether the driver will perceive the innovation, and so whether the driver will be willing to buy a car with that particular innovation. The paradigm of Industry 4.0, one of the paradigms of Industry 4.0 is actually digital twins. Creating digital twins is very much important because with, for example, the digital twin of a car, we are able to actually mimic the actual performance of a car. So, developing digital twins is fundamental to allow a smooth design process, and that actually is essential for Industry 4.0 processes. In the previous example that we have seen, we see that digital twins actually are needed to describe the performance of components before they are actually built. Our driving simulator is actually a digital twin of the actual car. And by means of these two digital twins, we actually can create a digital twin of the whole vehicle and actually create a design process that is based on such virtualization. That is, as I mentioned, a paradigm of Industry 4.0. In the next speeches and presentations, we will deal with digital twins and how they match with Industry 4.0. Diego Minen, Engineer Diego Minen, will present the cable-driven driving simulator of the Politecnico di Milano. Then, Dr. Vignati will talk about advances and design process speed up by means of the simulation that he and his colleague perform at the Politecnico. Professor Gobbi will briefly present advances in design services and in component design related to test as well. And finally, we will have a discussion. So I leave the floor to Engineer Minen, who will start with the first presentation. Diego, you can share the screen. I leave you the possibility to share the screen.
Yes, thank you, Giampiero.
Okay,
I'm about to share my presentation. Please let me know if you can see it.
We can see it.
Okay. Yes, my presentation is quite specific on the motivation that drove us toward the design of this machine, and that are mainly motivation that the automotive market is looking for to be able to better approach the implementation of the various complex components in a car much ahead the car, a real mule, could exist. So in recent time, I would say that the main motivation for designing simulator are coming from the ADAS connected electric vehicle paradigm and of course exploding market at the same time. So the simulator should reflect also this need the automotive industry has by means of increased workspace for sure, low latency, low noise type of simulator with possibly harmonized multisensorial immersion and with being able to have a driving experience as a passive, semi-active and active driver, even for non-trained people, as well as at the same time, more and more having the need of being able to reproduce comfort. On the other hand, if you want the more traditional side of the implementation of driving simulator was the low high frequency for handling dynamics, always to be, of course, harmonized for having natural immersion. And when I talk vehicle dynamics, it's not only the vehicle that we want to put on the simulator, but all its subsystem modeling at various levels. Could be from very simple software model to a more complex hardware in the loop model, meaning that, for example, an electronic board for controlling traction could go and feed the physical model on the simulator. Of course, in the traditional sense, also ride and comfort and the sustainable motorsport. This, if somebody want to develop a simulator, including all that, probably is on the right direction. Very often you have seen or even have heard about big simulator. In reality, no driving simulator could ever be big enough to reproduce one-to-one low frequency acceleration in a generic maneuver. Therefore, more than looking at how big a simulator is and how big acceleration could be, what is important is that the perception, the human perception that I call here HDP, human dynamic perception, is satisfied. Because no matter what, simulator is a machine that is a subset of a dynamic experience with respect to reality. Because of course, steady acceleration cannot be reproduced for too long time. Therefore, we have been working quite intensively in recent time to understand what the perception requirements are for keeping the workspace the same. So we try to, of course, optimize all this motion of the simulator and also collateral element that I'm going to describe. If we consider the ideal simulator, let's call size, of course, increasing it, several different elements have to be considered. For example, if you consider frequency response, it is quite obvious that the bigger the simulator is, the more difficult it is to have it responding with high frequency. Therefore, you have to abandon ideas to do MVH or ride of a certain type. Then the bigger the simulator, is true that, that there is more acceptance for normal drivers. The blue curve is showing an increasing of acceptance, but beyond a certain limit, really this increase is not so much appreciable. At the same time, of course, cost, the general cost, beside the cost of the machine itself, but the cost of implementation, the operational cost of the machine increase a lot. If we consider interdepartmental efficiency, for example, you want to use for handling, for ride, for MVH, for ADAS, for even vehicle dynamics advanced, then we have understood after having done some also investigation on what is around, even how our machine are used, that the probably the size, the market is oriented toward is in the range of 2 to 5 meter space. The Politecnico Milano simulator has a workspace of 4 by 4 meter, and by the way, with independent X and Y, and also can span plus or minus 6 degree yaw. So we think to be in the right window in this case. Regarding the frequency range, the frequency response, which is important aspect also for the natural perception of and the virtual experience, we consider that at low frequency we have the so-called somatovestibular perception that we identify with this simple line with increase or decrease. Then from 5 to 30 hertz we have the so-called vestibular vibrational perception, and of course we have overlapping of different perception in these frequency ranges. And from 30 and 150 hertz is what we perceive as vibrational type of feeling, and from 20,000 hertz everybody knows that we have the acoustic. Now, for making a good experience in the simulator, one has to implement element that could cover all the frequency range, possibly with managing superposition, blending, and so on and so forth. And what VIAGRID has done also for the Politecnico simulator, also under suggestion of the Politecnico, for certain element, we have an active seat, active belt, we have shakers, we have high frequency response steering system, we have active brake. All these together with the motion platform, which excite the vestibular system in the human brain, makes the acceptance higher. If we talk about performance harmonization, then clearly we have, if you consider the various subsystems, so suppose you have a driver, could be a robot driver, could be a human driver that gives input to the machine. In our case, we have a concurrent real-time computer which runs the physics model, which we call CARealTime, that to which we can connect any type of, for example, MATLAB extension for making it, for expanding its functionality. We can connect any order in the loop. And then the physics model together with this subsystem can generate states for the motion queuing, and the motion queuing and the output of this in a very simple supposed static simulator in which you have just a seat producing a steering torque. Then of course you need the graphics for following the trajectory that your vehicle physics is developing, and then you need audio, then you need for example a frequency like shakers, and then you need low frequency element like seat and belt active, and at the end you want to have a motion of the platform. In all, what the human perceive is a a simultaneous input of these subsystems that each one excites is on sensorial, one particular sensorial, of course, channel of the human. So one has to also consider that this all these input have to be harmonized. One has to consider what are latencies, what are the frequency of each, what is the let's say synchronization. That is very important, and is what we have done a lot for the Polytechnical Simulator. Regarding the short history, this cable simulator was conceived in September 2015. Then we got a patent in May 16, and we have been studying the machine for about 3 years until the June 19, and at the end the machine was installed in our sim center in June 2020. As you know, the machine at Politecnico was first time was put in operation in October 2020. And the back history of that, we have done an extensive study for an European automaker, BMW, and we wanted to see the, well, BMW wanted to see the feasibility of such a system, and that at the end we would have been ready much before. They choose a different solution that is still under construction. But to tell you that there is much history behind this type of principle. Regarding the simulator workspace, another important thing in the DIN 400, we try to maximize the usage of the planar workspace, in the sense that the disk frame underneath can undergo plus or minus 2 meter travel and plus or minus 6 degrees yaw in all positions. So there is no dependency among the degree of freedom. Another thing we worked on a lot was to allow vertical travel to understand what is the, let's say, the behavior of the vehicle when there is an important vertical acceleration, but without sacrificing too much the ability to do X and Y motion of the upper stage of the simulator for high frequency, as well as roll and pitch. So we let's say, concentrated on this. Just to explain with a graphic picture, I show you what is the shape of the workspace. The more workspace of a simulator is kind of a parallelepiped is the better, because it means that you're moving on one axis, and on the other you don't have much restriction on the third axis, for example the dependency of the Z availability on the X and Y motion or on the pitch and roll. The simulator we are talking about installed at Politecnico is a 9 degree of freedom motion platform. In reality, of course, at the end you have 6 degree of freedom on the cockpit, but the motion is given with redundancy. Why with redundancy? Because on top of the disk frame that moves in 3 degree of freedom, we have an hexalive that moves also in 6 degree of freedom, and we use high frequency X, Y, and yaw. Not to have cable overloaded with following high frequency. And it's much better to move in high frequency a system that has less mass, less inertia on top, than to moving it entirely. Then we have a special system called inertia compensation system, which is, you can think about it as being noise cancellation. This subsystem basically is, I don't know if there is an animation here. No, it's later. The inertia compensation system act basically in a counter phase with respect to hexalift X, Y, and yaw in order not to transmit to cable high frequency vibration. We have done extensive simulation of the simulator before with using ADAMS, with using MATLAB control, and we basically were quite ready with the control when the first prototype of the machine was assembled. The logic of the machine is kind of different from other simulator, because we have the lower stage, the cable control is done via force, door control, then of course one has to compute the desire the desired acceleration for the disk frame, but on the disk frame we act with the ICS, and the ICS is basically eliminating by moving in counterphase with the hexalift, is eliminating some of the frequency, and we basically act on the inverse dynamic of the disk frame to come to pull a torque with a clean subset of acceleration. And then everything is transformed into needed motion that for the D400 motion control, of course, together with the pulley torque for the big motor, and then through a PMAC, which is a real-time Linux computer, is then fed to the driver for obtaining the motion that you can basically see when the machine is in action. Yes, I've talked about this already regarding the extended degree of freedom, the extended Z travel, with keeping still quite interesting planar motion. Let me skip this slide. I don't know how much time I have left. 10 minutes, 5 minutes?
Please, as you wish, go ahead.
As I wish, okay.
So interesting.
Okay, so you see in this picture the extension of this mechanism. Interesting in this mechanism is that its stiffness is increasing with vertical travel. And this is also something logic for a simulator, because if you think about going in a compression with a car, you need to go up with a top disc, so where the cockpit is mounted, to have basically the sensation of vertical acceleration that is squeezing the driver to the seat. At this point, I have to go up, and I want the stiffness of the machine going up, because all the forces that I transmit are higher, becomes higher. And so this nonlinear stiffness of the mechanism allows to have the right structure for reproducing the acceleration in the right situation, fundamentally. Also, the kinematic chain of this special mechanism is very favorable to have, let's say, a more suitable comfort when actuators are operated, because the actuators do not operate directly against the top disc. We call this triangular structure which support the cockpit, but instead the motor are put horizontal, and then there is this slide and the six rods connected. So this gives sensation, say, a more comfort in general while submitting vertical acceleration. Yeah, you see the machine in motion in this slide, and you see how, for example, we move the masses of the ICS counteracting the planar motion of the cockpit, and which means X, Y, and yaw. Normally, we want to keep, I have this sentence at the bottom here, we want to keep residual acceleration below what we call the threshold. The threshold acceleration for a human being is 0.05 meter per square second. Means that below this acceleration is difficult for a vestibular system to perceive any. So our cancellation target with ICS was set to that value. Regarding the mechanism, mechanics and control, we have at VIAGRID, we provide the full, let's say, turnkey for a driving simulator from the physical model of the vehicle, which is called Carrier Time, to the software for controlling the machine, which is called motion queuing, but going through, of course, let's say, using what I mentioned, the Power PMAC real-time computer, we control through a concurrent machine, which is the same machine on which we run the physical model. We control the axis drives. There is a communication that goes back and forth to sending comment to the machine, getting machine position and optimizing the whole flow with this technology, fundamentally, that we for the first time put together, thanks also to the collaboration we got with Todema, a company that have excellent technology for mechatronics. Another important aspect, not very explicit here, is that we have a safety redundancy for the machine. Clearly, the machine is pulled by cable. These cables extremely higher, probably 30 or 40 times higher than the all possible limit force that we transmit with the simulator. However, clearly, we have a way with laser, with a laser system, and also with a wired encoder to know exactly what the position of the machine instantaneously is, and being able to keep it within the plane of motion in all conditions. Also, we have photodiodes, and we have a motor encoder, which give us the complete safety. And all this has to go through a system that balance all the action on the machine during the various operation. For example, loading or going to a normal position or going to an extreme or whatever type of maneuver. I'm now spending some time describing some performance in comparison with other simulator, still of VA grade. So suppose we want to go through a double lane change maneuver. Then, due to limited workspace, for example, our DIM-150 simulator, which moves plus or minus 0.75 meter, gives the yellow curve. So the blue curve being the reference acceleration for the vehicle. On a simulator, you can at maximum give the yellow. Then, if you move to DIM-250 simulator, in reality, you have the gray curve. So you increase the level of acceleration thanks to more workspace. If you go to the DIM 400, we almost reach, in this case, the 1G acceleration of the passenger car through that maneuver with the red curve. But then we discuss the other element, because this just is vestibular perception. On the right side, you can see what we can do with adding, for example, the active seat for lateral perception. And then all curve increase to the point that, for example, the red curve can match the blue, but on the smaller simulator, you can for sure increase the acceleration perception, but you can never reach the one-to-one. So the DIM 400 size has been also chosen for being able to try to reproduce one-to-one with all the elements possible, the acceleration in a passenger car during an isolated change maneuver. Another example I want to make is of a brake maneuver. As you see from the left picture, you see the blue curve is a typical longitudinal profile acceleration in a brake. Due to limited workspace, all simulator, the 150, the 250 and the 400 can provide you a certain amount of acceleration, instantaneous acceleration. The 400 could reach the peak of a passenger car, but then there is a so-called washout of acceleration. Differently, you would need too much space. Clearly, if you brake at 1G a car for 5 seconds, then it is the acceleration is 10 meters per second. 10 meters per second, the time is 5 seconds, the square is 25, then the space required is S equal 1 over 2 acceleration times square. So if you make a simple calculation, you have that the space required for braking at 1G, one car, for 5 seconds is 25 times 10, 250 divided 2, you would need a simulator 125 meters long. So clearly, it is something impossible. For this reason, somebody sometimes is for the first time he approached the driving simulator concept, he could remain. But how can you feel? Yeah, in reality, what the driving simulator is machine for transient perception. So if you want, is more a jerk. What driver feel, especially expert driver feel the jerk. If you do a constant acceleration maneuver, after a while, all is constant, and who cares? But obviously, for a normal person, the missing of the steady acceleration could also be sometime source of discomfort or surprise. But that is what a driving simulator can do. I don't think we want or can produce simulator under meter long for the maneuver I described before. On the right hand side, you see what how we can fill this diagram with adding active seat, active belt in this case. So we push the chest of the driver with a signal that is the green signal that acts later with respect, of course, the action, the vestibular action of the platform, but that altogether can come to the, I think, black or dark blue curve that gets much more closer to the blue one. Basically, we add the steady state contribution acceleration, and we have 10-year experience of several driver, I would say 100, if not thousands of driver, in our sim center, which all felt more comfortable with having also this additional cue of the belt. For simplicity, I did not show the other simulator curve, but clearly the DIN 400 is the one that does this job better. The bigger the workspace, the better you can do the blending between, let's say, short transient and long transient for acceleration, low high frequency response and low frequency response of the cue. So it is welcome that we have more space, no matter what. Obviously, one has always to negotiate compromises. Continuing on this, the same discussion, we also thought about the performance index of a simulator. So if we consider that the performance index of a simulator could be identified with the level of acceleration you can produce and somehow multiplied by the time at which you can produce this acceleration, then with a simple equation like this, you discover that at the very end, the perception of transition acceleration is proportional to the velocity of the simulator that can develop. Of course, you can develop a high velocity if you have even low acceleration with a lot of travel, or vice versa. But no matter what, if I have exposed to high velocity, somehow means that if the simulator can reach high velocity, somehow depends on the intensity of acceleration and the space available. For what regard the rotational perception instead, what is important for the human brain, for the vestibular system, are rotational velocities. In this case, if you consider the perception to be proportional to rotational velocity and the time of exposure, it comes that you have the yaw angle. So even increasing the yaw angle in a driving simulator increase the perception. Now I'm showing you on the right radar plot, spider plot, the RMS of a certain maneuver in various simulator. Again, we are fighting against ourselves, via grade, with smaller simulator. You see what is the level of perception or performance index with respect to the DIN 400, the yellow spider versus the other colors. If I do that for a combined acceleration type of maneuver instead of an obstacle avoidance, this is more braking in a turn type of thing, you see the perception the area is even higher, and this is what you could have in terms of performance index on a track with a sport car. At the very end, the performance index is when somebody jumps down and says, oh, I felt this acceleration and I felt this transient for enough time for me to be able to control the vehicle. This is what the driver, expert driver, would tell you. Obviously, if they have to guess from short duration of time of even high acceleration or longer duration of time or lower acceleration because you have to respect the platform limit, then as a subtle modification in the car, could it be mechanical, could it be control system, is more difficult to recognize. So at the very end, the performance index of a simulator is the ability to recognize the variation of the vehicle model intended in all senses by an expert driver. In the case of a normal driver, is the ability to perceive the comfort, for example, of a normal maneuver or even of an ADAS system when in action. Yes, this was a slide for Giampiero.
Ci siamo.
You have seen probably a lot of animation of the D400, but I would say that this concludes my presentation. Of course, I'm open to any question.
Thank you very much, Diego. Since we know that you are on the way back home, if there are any questions for you so that we can leave you driving back.
Yeah, it's not a problem. I mean, a comfortable area, parking area. But okay. Tell me, okay. I mean, I'm open to questions, no problem.
Okay. We will go on at least 15-20 minutes with two more presentation. The next one will be given by Michele Vignati. So I invite Michele to share the screen if you are able, and take control and go ahead with your presentation.
Okay, I hope you can see the screen, my screen, correctly.
Perfect.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Giampiero, for the introduction. I just want to give you a very brief overview of some of the activity that we carry on in our department that can fulfill all the opportunity given by the dynamic driving simulator. So this is more or less the agenda of the activity. And the very first one is related to vehicle dynamics. Of course, what we have in the department is an instrumented car, and the car is full with a lot of sensors that try to measure all the possible quantities that are important for the car dynamics. There are some advantages of this approach. Of course, we have real-world data, so we can do everything on the car, and we are sure that these data are representative of the real world, and we can also do vehicle dynamics, we can do comfort, we can do NVH, but there are some cons in this approach, and of course the first one is the cost. The car has to be maintained as well as the sensors. You have to pay the truck if you want to perform some particular maneuvers. And of course you have the noise, which is natural in sensors. And you have just one car. Unfortunately, we have this car. We don't have a sport car, but if we want to change just one parameter, it's not possible. So if we want to change the suspension, there is no possibility to do it. And last but not least, we have a safety issue. If we want to test a maneuver around the Polimi department, it's not so safe because we can be involved in accidents. Of course, some of the maneuvers we can do on this car can be correctly done in the dynamic simulator. And with the simulator, of course, we have safety. First of all, we have an infinite set of car parameters. We can switch in 5 minutes from the compact car to a sport car or to a truck just by clicking a few mouse button. And then of course we have all the quantities associated to the car dynamics that we want. So we don't need to spend a lot of time to mount a specific sensor in a specific position of the car. Of course there are some cons and that are limited to the simulator characteristics that Diego showed us in the previous presentation. So strictly related to the vehicle dynamics, what we have is the problem of developing state estimators in the car. You can see here in the picture, there is a car that is performing a drift maneuver or a power slide maneuver. And you know that in this maneuver, the important thing is that the velocity of the car is not aligned with its x-axis. So the side slip angle is a very important parameter for this type of maneuver. So what we try to do is to create some mathematical models that are called estimators that try to have this parameter, because this parameter is not possible to be measured in normal cars, because the sensor you need to measure the side slip angle is very expensive. But moreover, we can estimate another parameter, which is the friction coefficient. So if I have the laser pointer here, you can see that you can design an estimator that also estimates the friction coefficient between the tire and the road. Of course, this can be done on the road with the car we saw before, but with the simulator, this becomes faster and safer. Then there is another important topic. You want to simulate the car behavior because you want to test your estimator in simulation before going with driver in the loop. But then, of course, you need to model the driver. So we develop models that try to reproduce what the driver thinks while he is driving, because the driver is not just a robot that follows a trajectory, but for example, drivers are characterized by the GG diagram. So you can have drivers that drives only in pure longitudinal or pure lateral condition, or you have race driver that drives also in combined acceleration condition. So the driving simulator becomes a very important tool that we have to optimize these driver models. Another interesting application is associated to road safety. Here you can see the CFD of a truck that is passing in case of high lateral wind close to these wind screens. What is important in this condition is that we have to know not only what is the vortex generated by the windscreen, but we have also to understand what will be the driver feeling of this windscreen, because you know that the car can be driven by, okay, the driver decide where to go, but the driver is also responsive to the disturbances that comes from the environment. So it is very important in this case to evaluate what is the effect of crosswind on heavy vehicles and on vehicles with trailer. Of course, this is a combined research, because we first do the test in wind tunnel where we get the coefficients for aerodynamic forces. Then we do CFD to test new shapes, new solutions to change this coefficient, and then finally we need the driver to drive the car and see if some effect may be dangerous for the car itself. The last application is to develop control systems to improve the car lateral dynamics. For example, torque vectoring is an application of a lateral control system that aims at maintaining the car stable during turns or in mu split condition. And of course, since the active system is modifying the car behavior, it is important to understand if the driver is conflicting with these active systems or not. So we do all our testing of the control strategy by simulations without the driver in the loop, or with robo drivers that are running inside the simulation. But finally, we need to test these active systems with the driver. And of course, testing high extreme maneuvers in the dynamic simulator is much safer than going on the road. Okay, this was my presentation. I went very fast because the time was limited, but of course, if you have questions at the end of the webinar, I'm here for answering. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Michele. Very good. You see the references here. And now I invite Massimiliano Gobbi, Professor Gobbi, to contribute and show what can be done in the field of vehicle components. Okay, thank you, Massimiliano.
Thank you, so let's get to the full screen presentation. Can you see correctly the screen?
Yes, please. Yes.
Okay. Okay. So just a few minutes to complement what the colleagues have already told related to the simulators and simulation and so on, and something else. I just want to add some relevant aspects related to activities which are needed to correctly apply the simulator and the vehicle models. These activities are related to measurements, to indoor testing, and to the modeling of vehicle components. I will give you just some highlights. It is really important to get the correct mass properties of the vehicle for performing correct simulation and for correctly apply the simulator itself. In this slide, you can see the Intenso Plus system, which is an approach developed by Politecnico di Milano to measure both the location of the center of gravity and the full inertia tensor of both vehicles and subsystems. The method is based on a multifilar pendulum in which we have three rods. We are monitoring and measuring the motion and the forces acting on the current frame of the vehicle, and on the basis of a proper mathematical procedure, we are able to compute the center of gravity location and the inertia tensor components. I want to emphasize the relevance of getting this kind of information. I always tell to my students, when you have a physical model that can be very complex and very well developed, you have always to remember that if you put incorrect parameters in the model, you will get incorrect results. So the I can say garbage in, garbage out. For this reason, getting this type of information is utmost important while applying the driving simulation. Further details are in the slide that I just showed. Focusing on another subsystem, that is the suspension system, at the laboratory of safety of transport at Politecnico di Milano, we have some indoor testing facilities that can be used for measuring forces, moment, acceleration, displacement, up to very high frequencies by monitoring forces at moment at each suspension connection to provide a correct representation in terms of the elastokinematic behavior of the suspension of the subsystem that will be modeled inside the driving simulator. This can also be used for modeling purpose, optimization purpose, for defining specific NVH performance indexes. This is possible by using specific sensors which have been developed for measuring forces and torques with a very high bandwidth and with a very high stiffness level, as highlighted in this slide, which has been developed internally at Politecnico. Further details also in this case are provided in this slide. Finally, referring to components or subsystems, I just want to highlight as an example a gearbox. So we need to develop the proper model of the subsystem that can be included in the loop of the driver simulator, and this can be used by integrating proper techniques of optimization and robust design to vary the parameters of the subsystem, and the driving simulator is necessary to evaluate subjectively and in an objective way the perception of the modification, as an example of this gearbox, on the actual behavior of the vehicle, without having to resort to very expensive and time-consuming tests on an actual vehicle in which the new gearbox will be installed. Many of these sensors, test rigs, and so on have been developed at Polimi, and actually some of them are actually developed and sold by a spin-off of Polimi, which is presented in this slide. I think I've been fast enough. So
thank you very much for being strictly into the time allotted. I'm very happy that we are still time for a discussion at the moment. And I would ask whether people have any question. They can unmute their own microphone and ask questions on the topic that we have dealt with in these presentations. Please don't have any don't be shy. And ask us whichever curiosity you may have on the topics that we have seen. Of course, that you have seen that there are a number of different topics, quite different topics, that all of them are crucial to design properly a vehicle, because we actually want to squeeze somehow all the many different activities into a smooth process that is enabled by the driving simulator. You may have seen how complex and how many different topics we have to address to deliver a safe and comfortable vehicle. This huge complexity is one of the paradigms that the automotive design is based on. So you may have really many questions, I suppose. If you don't have them at the moment, you may have in the future. Okay, you may take advantage from the presence of Engineer Minen, who has designed our driving simulator, and he is really, I would say, the most effective, important,
and successful designer of driving simulator in the world. Without any doubt, I would say that it is really we are proud to cooperate with him, because he actually did a lot, and the expertise and the products that are sold by VI Grade are very well recognized all over the world, with tens of driving simulators sold to the most important OEMs all over the world. So don't.
Thank you very much, Giampiero.
Don't miss the opportunity. Please. Okay.
I have two small questions on the hardware of the simulator. The first one is how is control the system to have a very smooth surface to move in the horizontal plane, our simulator? And the second one was is in the cockpit. It's possible to change the seat, the steering wheel, the pedal, and so on, to change the type of car from, let me say, compact car to very sport car, because I mean, the final position of the driver is very different from one to another.
Thank you, Gianluca. Very, very good questions. I would leave Diego to answer.
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Well, the control of the lower part of the simulator is a force control. So we have a feed forward logic to basically apply the desired torque, the motor, to realize the acceleration that we want, at the same time X, Y, and yaw.
And excuse me, Diego, maybe you should stress the pneumatic sliders.
Yes, maybe I did not mention before, the machine is sliding in a plane over a subtle film of air, subtle as 30 microns, and this film of air is kept stable by a pulling electromagnet that is also possibly could be made active. However, the is not trivial. It's not been trivial to develop a control system to have the right precision without any, let's say, noise or unpleasant effect in terms of perception. Always we are going to this direction with an element that you think is a marine type of cable. These cables are made of a high modulus polyethylene, never used for such an application. And the feedforward control is working together with the feedback control. And the two things are harmonized to obtain the desired motion. Regarding the other question for the cockpit, yes, you can put any cockpit on top of the 400. The maximum load is probably over 600 kilos. Then you have to, with respect to this value, then you can put whatever geometry.
Perfect. He was also asking about the cockpit and the different cockpits and seats and steering wheels.
Yes, the seat and steering wheel can also be replaced and basically put any type of element of this kind in existing cockpit, or can be also swapped in other cockpit that one can, of course, design. As to respect, of course, the mechanical and electrical and electronical connectivity, but we have a quite standard front panels to plug all this.
Thanks a lot.
Okay, any more questions? Do you have any curiosity? Of course, we have shown you topics of our researches that we perform together with the main OEMs working in Europe, but also outside Europe. And all of the presentation are actually the result of months and years of hard work from our researchers. So we have squeezed the presentation into a couple of slides, but beyond and beneath such slides, there's a huge amount of work, and we would be delighted if you would be interested in asking more questions and maybe in future webinars, because this this webinar is just a first introduction of what we do. We hope in the future to focus on specific topics that may deal with even one single topic that we have presented today, and that can be explained in hours. So let us, I would say, if there are not any more questions, let us stop here for this evening. I hope we will meet you tomorrow evening at 6 p.m. again for another webinar. And the second one of the first four webinars that we will that will start our activities at the driving simulator of the Politecnico in Milano. If no more questions are issued, I thank very much Engineer Minen, Michele Vignati, Massimiliano Gobbi, my colleague Professor Kelly, for their effort in delivering this webinar. And of course, this webinar will be available on our website of the Politecnico. If you want to retrieve it and have a look to it, you will have no problem. Thank you very much, good evening, and hope to meet you again on the web tomorrow evening. Thank you.